Welcome to this slideshow about print substrates. I will talk about paper and environmental issues, and about plastic production and plastic types. I will talk about packaging and labels, and about corrugated boards. First of all, let's see what paper is. We have to begin with the issue that paper has always been accused of being environmentally damaging. So everyone knows that a farmer must sow before he can reap. Here we have a cornfield, and every year the farmer is harvesting all this corn, and after that he sows new corns. The same goes for an oat field. And what about a Christmas tree field? Here we have a farmer who is producing Christmas trees, or just trees. Is this an environmental issue? Maybe not. But if he will have a sustainable business, he must sow new trees every year. So let's move on to more greater trees. For instance, like this one, this could be an IKEA furniture tree field. Every year they harvest the trees to produce their furniture, and they sow new trees. However, if we talk about paper, there is a lot of trouble in the media about no, this is bad for environmental, paper is bad. This is a common meaning of the public, apparently. But the paper industry also need new trees every year, and therefore they plant and they sow new trees. And that has resulted in that European forests have been growing by over 1,500 football pitches every day since 2005. So it has in fact been growing by 44,160 square kilometers. This is an area as large as Switzerland that has this is new forest. So you see, if you are in the paper industry business, you need trees, and therefore you plant a lot of trees. So this is not bad for environment, on the contrary. What can you do as customer, as a client, if you choose paper products? You can look for these eco label that there are. We have the PEFC. This is a program for endorsement of forest certification. This is an international non-profit, non-governmental organization dedicated to promoting sustainable forest management through independent third-party certification. And we also have the FSC, which is almost the same. It's also independent, non-profit, non-governmental organization established to support environmentally appropriate and social beneficial and economical viable management of the world's forests. And in Scandinavia, we have this Nordic Swan eco-label, and this is an official eco-label for the Scandinavian countries. It's a voluntary, and it's a positive practical tool for consumers to help them actively choose environmental and sound products. This is not only for paper, but also all kinds of products. If you look for these eco-labels, you as a customer have chosen an environmental friendly product. And when we have used the paper, most of the time it will be recycled. And recycled paper, and this might be from books and brochures and newspapers and advertising and so on. Recycled paper is used for new paper, we call that recycled paper, and for newsprint, which is newspaper paper, and for egg trays, for cardboard boxes, and for corrugated cardboard, and other similar packaging products made from wood fiber. So it is a very huge industry of recycled paper. So we reuse the resources again and again. And if we look at what environmental trends there are in into the packaging and print production industry, we see that we go from metal to plastic, and we go also from plastic to paper. Here we, on your right side, you have a Carlsberg Pilsner. At the moment, they are experimenting on going away from the plastic bottle and try to make paper bottles. This is an experiment, but this is what they want for the future. And on your left side, you see that Carlsbergs have, of course, the aluminium beer cans with less plastic wrapped around than before. So this is also a way of looking into environmental issues. So let's begin to see how paper is produced. First of all, we, as I mentioned before, we have all the trees that will be cut down and harvested, and they will be transported into a timber warehouse where they will be debarked. And then all these timber would be chopped up into wood chips, which go into a sawdust state. And then it gets boiled, and you get a filtration and a washing, and you go into the bleaching because you don't want yellowish paper. And then you go to a post-filtration and you get dried, and then you have made a pulp, as they call it. This is a paper mass, and this goes into the paper machine, and it gets dried, and then you have the rolls of paper that is cut out into smaller rolls or into sheets that can be printed. And then it will become distributed. So this is a sketch of how paper is produced. So what's in a tree that we want? Inside every tree, inside every plant, you have the fibers. And the fibers is what we use for producing paper. And we can get those fibers out of the tree by chemically separating the fibers. We will get some smooth and good fibers, or mechanically separating the fibers. Then they will get damaged a little bit, but this is good enough for some paper types. In between all these fibers, there is a stuff called lignin. And this is what makes the paper yellow if it is lying in the sun, for instance. So they want to separate the lignin because we don't want that into a white piece of paper. Here we have a picture from the Handbook of Print Media, and here you see how the wood is cut into smaller pieces, and then it comes into the paper machine here, and they debarken it, and they begin to separate the fibers. And here we have the pulp. This is the trees that has been transformed into sawdust, and it is now mixed with water and with adhesives. Here you see an illustration of the wood fibers, and this is what we want for the paper production. When we have this pulp, it is transferred into the paper machine as into the long, long wires, and the paper is smoothened out and dried up. And here you have a picture of a paper machine where the pulp is fed onto the wire and the web, and eventually dried in the end and rolled up. So as you can see, this is a large, very large proportions here. Here we have a cross section of a paper machine, and as you can see up here, this one is 120 meters long, and in the one end we have the pulp going in, and it has it goes through the wires and it gets dried and heated and calendared. I will come back to that, and then it is rolled up as finished paper over here. If we want a nice print result, we would like to print on coated paper. And if we begin in the middle here, we have the base paper, the dried pulp, which has become base paper. And on each side of this paper, we want a chalk layer a coating, we call that. This way we have a nicer and more smooth surface of the paper, and this gives a better print result. Here we have a cross section of it. So it gets a chalk layer on each side of the paper, and here we see a micro photo of that. You can see this is the base paper here, all the wooden fibers, and then the surface has been closed by a layer of chalk. So this gives us the best print result, the nicest image. So at the end of the printing, or at the end of the paper machine, the paper has, it is possible to make the surface more smooth and glossy. And by doing this in the calendrating machine like this, the surface is ironed, you might say, or smoothened out, and then it becomes a more glossy coated paper. And then it is rolled up into very large rolls, and you can cut it out into sheets afterwards. And here we have an overview of what sizes there are, standard paper sizes. Most people know the A4 size. This is 210 by 297 millimeters, and this A4 is the half of an A3, which is the half of an A2, which is the half size of an A1, which is the half of an A0. So this is the A standard sizes for paper. We also, this was the A series. We also have a B series and a C series. The B series is mostly for posters, for instance, for books, for envelopes, and for passports. You might know the poster format 50 by 70. And if we look into the C series, these are primarily for envelopes. And then we have the United States, Canada, and the Philippines. They use another paper size format. They use what they call a letter size, or legal and tabloid, and so on. And they use inches in this part of the world. If you look into the standard A4, you see it here. And then in the American, they have the letter size. This corresponds to the A4. But as you can see, it is not as tall as an A4, but it is wider than A4. So here I have placed an Apple Mac logo, because if you have a Mac and you are using paper in Word, for instance, word processing programs, then your default might be set to a letter size format. And when you want to print out on an A4 printer, you can get some problems. So you might want to see that. If we go back to the paper's surface properties, then we have a newsprint here. This is a paper for newspapers. As you can see, this is a very rough type of paper, and there's no surface coating on it. The same goes for an uncoated paper, and here we see the coated paper as I showed you before. If you go downwards, you have the coated paper surface here, and here you have the uncoated paper surface. As you can imagine, if I want to print on this paper and on this paper, the coated will give me the best print results. So the paper surfaces determine how the print results will end up. If we look into some of the paper properties, we talk about the fiber orientation, and these are the wood fibers that now has become into paper fibers. How are they placed in your sheets? And we call that the fiber orientations, the direction of the grain, the fibers. There's a long grain or short grain. And the long grain, this is fiber orientation parallel to the length side, and the short grain is oriented parallel to the narrow side of the sheet. And this is important if you are producing a book or a magazine and so on, because you have to glue the sheets and they have a, the product have a back where all the pages are glued together. So since fibers from the wood now in the paper is alive in a certain way, that means that they as most paper it expands if it is in moist environment, and it contracts in dry environment. So it is alive, it is changing size some millimeters. So this is important. Then we have the grammage, and this is an expression of how much 1 square meter of this paper weighs. And then we have the opacity, and this is how dense this paper is. If we have high opacity paper, it will block 95 to 100% of the light. And if you have low opacity, it will block less than 95% of the light. And this is important if you, for instance, print on two-sided products, for instance, book, brochures, and magazines, and so on. You don't want to see what is printed on the other side through the paper. So therefore, you would like to have a high opacity when you choose your paper. Then, of course, we have the thickness. This is in 1/1000 of a millimeter. And then we have the bulk. And the bulk is the ratio of the paper thickness to its weight. So if we have a high bulk paper, it is paper value above 1. This is a high density paper. And we have low bulk, which means that the value is under 1. So you can calculate it by using these formula. Or you just look up into the technical specification of this paper that you have chosen. You can also talk about the bottom structure of your paper. If you take a sheet of paper and you hold it up to the light and you look how the fibers or how the bottom is it smooth and even or is it uneven? If it is uneven bottom, you might see that when you print on it. So we can also talk about categories in for print. The names paper and card and cardboard and so on is on the one hand depending on the grammage, but on the other also related to the applications. So the following reference values are typical application to apply to. If you have paper, this is typical something that is less than 150 grams. And if you have card or cardboards, it is from 150 to 600 grams. And if you have board, it is more than 600 grams. Let's talk a little bit about labels, because labels can be produced on paper or plastic. But no matter what, labels consist of 4 different materials. Because we have the front or the face material. This might be paper, coated or uncoated, or it could be plastic. And we need an adhesive, the glue that is going to keep the label on your product. And then we have a release coating. So this is a silicone lay, and we have a release liner. So here, in any label production, self-adhesive labels anyway, you have 4 materials, and they can react to temperature and humidity conditions differently. So this is called the matrix. This is what you see over here, the part of the label production that is not going to be used, while this is going to be sent to the customer. Maybe this line will be split up in smaller rolls, so on. And now let's see what plastic is, because plastic is also a very large part of print production. In our daily life, we see all these signatures on our products. This is chocolate, and this is a PP, and that means what it kind of plastic this is. So we have these different types of plast, and we can see that PP is polypropylene, and this is used for many different things, from textile, packaging, carpet, stationery, life, and so on. So here you can see an overview of the different kind of plast types and what they are most commonly used for. And here you have a recycling symbols, and you can see how it should be recycled and what kind of products they are typically used for. I will come into that a little later. So you can go back to that if you are discussing some plastic issues. So how is plastic manufactured? Well, first of all, the raw materials are crude oil or cellulose or coal or natural gas and salt. However, only approximately 5% of the world's oil consumption is used for plastic production. The crude oil is refined in an oil refinery where the heavy crude oil is separated into lighter oil products, which consist of different mixtures of carbon and hydrogen chains that forms molecules of different size and structure. Subsequently, the plastic is formed in a process called polymerization, where so-called monomers are linked together to form longer polymer chains. So, after the refination of the crude oil and so on, the plastic can be added color. And eventually, plastic is transformed into dry granulate, like what you see on the pictures here. This is very easy to handle in the plastic factory, and this is now the new raw materials before we produce the actual plastic products. Here we see an example of how plastic is produced. First of all these dry granulates, as we saw before, they are put into a boiler, and then it is blown up in the air to a large balloon, which is folded and dried and rolled up into these rolls afterward. And this is the rolls that the printing houses, the printing companies can order and print on. Here we have another example of the same type of production. This is plastic that has been colored into a blue version, and then it is blown up to the balloon, which is collapsed and rolled into this roll of plastic that can be used in the printing house, for instance. You might also want to make bottles like plastic bottles, and it's the same principle. The melted plastic is going into a hollow form, and it is blown out into the form, and then it is dried up, and you have the finished bottle here. And you can print on that, or you can put a label on it. So I will now go into three or four types of typical plast types. First of all, we have the PET, the polyethylene, and this is relatively hard material, and especially known from products, as you know, electrical contacts, jugs, lunch boxes, soda and beer bottles, perfume, foil, photography, and x-ray films, and so on. In the graphic art industry, in print production, it is used for signs, for labels, and hard packaging. The strength of this material, it is very heat resistant, it is tear resistant, it is chemical resistant, and it has a good transparency and a good stiffness. But that also could be a weakness if you want to put it on a product that you have to squeeze, for instance. Then PET plastic would not be the right choice. Then we have the polypropylene. This is known for sweat transporting textile, that means sportswear from carpets, furniture, bags, roofs, ropes, stationary filters, reinforcement in concrete as well. In the print production, it is used for plastic bags, that is shopping bags, and for labels. And here you can have label foils that are very thin. This is good for label production. The strengths are that you can have these thin films, and therefore it is also very transparent, and you can create this no label look. If you want to put a label on a clear bottle and you don't want it to look like there is a label on it, you can choose this plastic type and create this no label look, and that way it looks like that the print is directly printed on the bottle. Then we have the polyethylene, and this is in two categories, the high density and low density. So in print production, this is normally used for packaging and for labels as well. One of the good things is it is very flexible and it is printable. You only have to corona treat before you print on it. And then it is conformable. You have a good squeezability. And if you, for instance, are printing a label that you put on a bottle of mayonnaise or something like that, you are squeezing the whole product if you want the product out of the bottle. And therefore, you also need to be able to squeeze the label without the label falling off. So you want a squeezability in these cases. And then there's many other plastic types, the nylon, the PS and the PVC. PVC is a little critical environmental wise. However, we use it in the print production for mega print, for outdoor, these digital print that we cover a whole building in these prints. These are typically PVC products. If we should, the three most common plastic types are set here side by side. We have already been into the strengths and weaknesses, but here you can see the P is flexible and it is printable and conformable. And here we have thin films possible, excellent transparency, no label look. That means you want a PP if you want to produce a label with a no label look. Or you can take the PET, which also has this no label look. If you want to test your plastic, if you have your product at home, for instance, if you peel off the label of your drinking bottle and see what kind of plastic is it, then you can put it in a glass of water. If it floats, it might be PE or PP. If it doesn't, it is maybe PET or PVC. But here you have to beware if there is any air bubbles under the label when you put it in the water. Is it flexible? Can you stretch it or squeeze it? The PE you can, and so can you with the PVC. Does it have good transparent properties? Then it might one of these three plastic types. In packaging, we see a new trend of going away from any form of artificial packaging. We don't want paper, we don't want plastic or other things. So now they are trying to experiment here. We see with bananas that is packed in the own banana leaves here. But as you see as well, you have two labels on it. So we need information about the product and the price and so on. We also see the large brands are trying to seek new opportunities for plastic production. Here we have Coca-Cola and Heinz ketchup. They have made plastic from plant oil instead of raw oil. So this is also a possibility. This is renewable plastic as well. And Adidas are promising that in 2024, all their shoes will be made of recycled plastic. So this is also an environmental trend that is going to affect us all. We see all kinds of strange product here. We have 100% recyclable and reusable. This bag is made of 20% recycled and non-woven material. And here I have a shopping bag, a plastic bag, which is green. It more than 85% is bio-based plastic. So, and then they talk about a standard that you can look up. So there is an environmental trend in all kind of product that we are going to be more sustainable. Last, we are going to look into packaging as an overall subject. Packaging, if you talk about food and food waste, for instance, then the fact is that packaged fruits and vegetables only give half as much waste as unpacked fruit. So if you put it in a box of somehow, it you don't have much food waste. A cucumber that is not packed loses fluid and becomes dull and unsellable within 3 days. But if you put it in 1.5 grams of packaging, you can keep it fresh for 14 days. And here supermarkets have only 20% less wastage on grapes when they are sold in bags or trays. The biggest impact comes from food, not from the packaging. So this is the conclusion of all this. So if we look into what kind of packaging type there are, we talk about the primary level. This is the packaging that has direct contact to the product. And then we have the secondary level, which is typically a package of the primary products, and with tertiary level as well. So here we have a primary packaging. This is packaging that has direct contact to the product inside. For instance, a pizza tray and the milk and flour. And here we have some strawberries. Is it blueberry? Anyway, this is a primary packaging that has direct contact to the product. And the secondary packaging is this yellow Fanta wrap that apparently has been wrapped around the primary packaging of a Coca-Cola. Here we also have the primary package and wrapped with the secondary package. And here we have the secondary package around the primary package, and the same for medical. Then we have the tertiary packaging. These are typical for transportation, and this is for secondary packaging. And this funny picture is that the designer has to, well, think of what is going to happen in the production afterwards. But this is tertiary packaging, also called transportation packaging. And what is this one? Is this transport packaging? It is a secondary packaging, maybe. If we look at the development in these times, we see that web shops are getting more and more orders. And that means that we need more packaging and more labels. Amazon is using a very huge amount of labels and packaging, as you see here, even though it is an online company. They use print products and packaging products. Last, we look into the corrugated board. This is to protect the product inside, and typically this is secondary or tertiary packaging products. And these comes in different forms depending on what kind of use you want to have. Here we have a single face, you can roll that around the product, and you have these single wall, double wall, and in different ways. And this is really to protect the product inside the box, for instance. If you want to print on this, you can either print directly onto the corrugated board, but you will not get a very high print quality, and the resolution of the print might only be from 28 to 34 lines per centimeter. However, you can also choose to print on a thin white paper, and then afterwards you can laminate this paper onto the surface of the corrugated board, and then you get a nice print result and a nice product look of this. So this was a short introduction to print substrates. However, I haven't talked about anything, and in real life it is possible to print on anything, in fact. So this was a short introduction. Thank you.